All right. So everybody's having a good week so far? What's up, bro? Everybody all right? All right, but everybody's having a good week so far. That's good, that's good. Nah, you good, boss. You good, boss. But let's go ahead and get right into it. If you could turn me your Bibles to James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18, that'll probably be the main text for this day's topic. Also, we're going to be in 1 John 2, 15 through 17 as well. So we're going to be at James 3, 13 through 18. Today we're going to talk about how ambition leads to an addiction. Talking about ungodly drives, ungodly ambitions. Each and every one of us are ambitious towards something. Therefore, I think this message is going to be very paramount for us who are endeavoring to go a place or go to a destination. So we're going to talk about some things that's really going to highlight what you and I need to do to ensure that we're driven with the right motives, that we're driven with the right insight, that we're driven for ultimate goal, which is to make our Father well pleased. So James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. James chapter 3. For those who's watching on Facebook Live, I want to greatly appreciate you guys for watching. Please get this broadcast out to everyone. Let your friends and family know that you watch Unplugged Live. Feel free to join us. Give me one second. What's up, y'all? What's up, y'all? We got ears. We done recruiting. I don't know. He might need to stay by his mama. He might. I don't know if he can handle all that now. All right. For those who's watching on YouTube, want to thank you guys for. Let's do that again. Thank you so much, guys, for watching on YouTube. We greatly appreciate you guys' support, man. Feel free to subscribe. Feel free to get this video out. I pray that this message will be a blessing to you. If you feel like what Unplug is doing is a benefit to you, your family, and others, feel free to donate. Feel free to subscribe. Feel free to share this video. Also, you can see a link in the bottom of this video in the description box. You will be able to download this great worksheet that goes along with this message. It'll help you kind of better understand what it is that I'm going to be sharing today. So feel free to pause the video, download that worksheet, and join with us and follow along with us. But thank you guys so much for your viewership and for being a part of this ministry online. But to go ahead and turn your Bibles as well to James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. The Bible reads, "Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but it's earthly, sensual, and demonic. For where envy and self-seeking or selfish ambition exist, and every evil things are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who seek peace." Let's go ahead and pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this word that you have given me. Father God, I thank you so much for your heart that desires for us to be freed from every chain, every addiction, every bitterness, every unforgiveness. And I pray, Father God, as I speak today, I speak as a man who is humbly submitted to you, a vessel empty of his own selfish ambitions, but full of your compassion for your great people. Lord, help us all align ourselves according to your will. Help us to be even more driven after your purpose, God. And I pray, Lord, as I speak today, there'll be so much clarity and insight, so much wisdom deposited in this room. It'll be as if you spoke. And I pray that you do speak. And I thank you, Father God, that your presence in this room, like I always say, God, we passionately, from our hearts, welcome you in this place, God, because with you not being here, we're wasting our time. It's only through your anointing that you destroy the yoke. So I pray, Lord, that this vessel is fully anointed for your purpose, for this moment. In Jesus' name we do pray, amen. Let's get right into today's problem. But I want to open the discussion with a question. I want three people to tell me, what are three things you feel fuels people to obtain success or to get whatever they desire? What are three things you feel? Oh, okay. Don't need to repeat it. There you go. What a Bishop with the red hat. Yes, sir. What are three things? What's one?
Pride.
Why pride? Just the short version. I know the words in you. Yeah.
Idolize success.
Exactly.
Right. I guess just boasting and just being too self-confident.
Yeah. That's good, man. So that's good. Fred, what you got, bro?
I would say low self-esteem.
Why that, bro?
Because if you see yourself lower, then you're going to try to work to be something great to try to make yourself.
Exactly. So pride, low self-esteem. Can I get some ladies? Go ahead, Miranda, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, man, we're going to get deep tonight. Yeah, this pretty much going to go an hour and a half. So why insecurity? I try to work with you. Okay. Why insecurities?
Because you're not content where you are, but people
going
after things that
don't
how you
care
about.
Yeah. So, yes, yeah.
Just to add to that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You just neglect asking God what you want to do. You just do it out of what I want.
Yeah.
Just what everybody else doing. Just the way I'm going to do it, God, regardless of what you want. Instead of considering Him and acknowledging Him.
Exactly. So when we talk about pride, low self-esteem, right, and insecurities, when you look at pride, pride is one of those things that destroys the bulk of people. A lot of people get so caught up in how can I make my name great versus making His name great? We get so caught up on what else can I do to make my name brighter? What else can I achieve to make people be in awe of me? And many of us, sometimes we have to be very careful that competition and competitive drives don't get in the way to boast ourselves up as if what we have accomplished is anything. It doesn't matter it doesn't matter how many things you accomplish in His life, it doesn't even come 1 inch or 1 ounce close to what Christ did in His life. So when you look at your accomplishments versus His accomplishments, it still fails in comparison. It still fails in comparison to a God who didn't have a degree, who didn't have a rich uncle. It still fails in comparison to what we esteem as success. Many people think that if I have all the degrees, if I'm very successful, if I'm prominent in my community, they feel as if I made myself this way. Man, I tell you one thing, I want to be God made than man made. I want to make sure that at the end of my life, they're going to be like, I see God's handiwork in His life. I see the script of God in His life. I don't want to be that type of guy where people can't even find God in the midst of my accomplishments. That's why sometimes God allows you to go the humblest roads, that God allows you to go the lowest roads, because He knows for a fact that in life, if you're driven to be proud, if you're driven to be noticed, that low self-esteem that says, you know what? I don't see myself correctly. I've been through all these different things, so now I got to try and prove to everybody else that I'm successful. Listen, you don't got to prove anything to get somebody else's approval, because if you live after everyone's approval, you'll die based on their criticisms. And most people are chasing after, please let me know what you think. Please let me know how you feel about it. We do it all the time. The way we angle our Instagram posts, the way we position ourselves, the way we dress, the way we shop, everything's based upon man's approval. But God said, while you was naked in your sins, I still pursued you and I chose you. But we spend all this money, waste all this time to make everybody else feel either beneath us or equal to us, when God said, man, that's vain, man. That's pointless. That you're going to allow that to be your drive? How many people have spent more money in Jordans, shoes, polos, suits, cars, houses, trips Man, people be going all over the world but don't have nothing to show for their own life. I don't want my life to be a photo album. I don't want my life to be based upon how many times you got a swipe. Oh, he must have had a good life. I want people to say he was here and he impacted culture. Photos fade, impact don't. So if I'm leaving, that's why I say I live my life. Lecrae said this. He said, I live to impact, not to impress. That right there stuck to me. Impression means it's only going to satisfy you for a moment. Impact, you can't shake that. I'm not going in that school to make sure I have the best J so the kids can be like, Coach Josh is cool. He got them 12s on. I want them to know, like, you know what? He left such an impact. We hope he doesn't leave. You got to leave such an impact that if your life is removed, that if your life is removed, people should feel your absence. But we want people to feel our presence. People feeling your presence doesn't compare to them feeling your absence. Because they only felt your presence, that means, oh, okay, that was a good moment. We had a great time. But, oh, if this person is gone, there's a void there. I tell people, there ain't too many Jordans out there. You can put Jordan on any team, they're guaranteed to make it to the championship. A lot of people are role players. But when you're a Jordan, people will know that you played. But so many of us, nothing wrong with being role players. But my thing is, you got to be so impactful in your own ability that when you're there, you have the work ethic, you have the mindset of a Jordan, that you are so great in what you do, driven to make sure that God gets the ultimate glory, that no matter what happens, when you retire from this life, people are going to know that you lived. I don't want my death to be the end of me. I want it to be the extent of me. I want people to say, man, we can't let this guy die. He may be physically dead, but he left so much life here. What are you leaving here? You got to make sure you leave life here so that when you die, people can still, there's people who's dead and gone. We still reading their books. We still watching their videos. We're still impacted. Michael Jackson, no matter how long he's been dead, they're going to still be playing them same songs 100 years from now. They're going to know that man lived. But my question to you is your drive so immersed in the will of God? It doesn't matter. If you're in God's will, people will know that you lived. Insecurities goes with low self-esteem. A lot of people become copies because of their insecurities. I'd rather be a copy of somebody else than be myself. Listen, the Bible says you're fearfully and wonderfully made. That when someone looks at you and you in the midst of God's will for you, you should be different. Listen, we're all different and equal in God's eyes. That's crazy. Different but equal. He don't love you more than me. He don't love me more than you. But he created us uniquely different. And he needs each person's uniqueness. That's why I tell people, man, do not allow your insecurities to cause your dreams to die. Don't allow those moments in your life where you felt inadequate to cause your dreams to die. Many people allow their insecurities to put the death to what they're called to do. How many people right now is not showing up to life because of what somebody else said? That's why I can care less what people think about me, what they may say about me. I know for a fact that if it's his will for me, it doesn't matter what I don't have. I know for a fact that if I have him, I'll be successful. Let's go to the problem. Many people in our world today are driving towards a destination, but with the wrong fuel. Many people are driven and fueled by jealousy and selfish ambition, but fail to realize that being driven by these things only leads to destruction. Many people in our world today are driving towards a destination, but with the wrong fuel. Many people are driven and fueled by jealousy and selfish ambition, but fail to realize that being driven by these things only leads to destruction. Did y'all get all the blanks? All right, let's go to the calls. The enemy and his system desires for us to focus on what other people have and why we don't have. This type of focus leads us to either try and match or surpass what others have, or to try and fill the voids in our hearts with material and emotional things. the cause. The enemy and his system desires for us to focus on what other people have and why we don't have. This type of focus leads us to either try and match or surpass what others have, or to try and fill the voids in our hearts with material and emotional things. Their goal is for you to build a desire beyond your physical ability and tempt you to utilize a supplement or a perverted emotion to bridge the gap. There is a gap in between your desire and your destination, and it's called your drive. And they want to cause that drive to stretch beyond its normal place, leading to burnout. It's so sad that we allow jealousy and selfish ambition to be our force to a destination, to be our fuel to a place. I tell people my greatest competitor is the guy I was yesterday. That's who I'm competing with. But when you get so caught up on competing with the person beside you, you miss out on your race. For those who ran track, they understand that if you focus on everybody else's lane, you may trip up in yours. Many times we get so caught up on what this person has that we now look at what they have and compare it to what we don't have. So all of a sudden, if I don't have what's trendy, if I don't have what's trending, then all of a sudden I'm nothing. How many people that we know that knows for a fact, if I don't have this thing in my life, I'm nothing? That we're allowing ourselves to be enslaved by material and emotional things. That if I don't have a relationship, I'm nobody. If I don't have money, I'm a nobody. If I don't have success, if I don't have these different things, then I'm a nobody. But when you measure your life based upon your closet or your companion, or you base it based upon what you have, then you'll become enslaved by the fluctuation of the prices of those things. Therefore, when a person says, you know what, that's my destination, that's who I want to be, that's where I want to go, they'll be able to say, you know what, the enemy knows, how can I get you to have a drive or ambition that stretches beyond your physical ability? Meaning, how many people burn themselves out working two or three jobs to get something that really doesn't matter at the end? At the end. Like the end. Like eternity. Like where God is. Like, I don't want to measure stuff based upon how the world defines success as. I want to base my life based upon what heaven defines life as. If you're a logical thinker and you compare time to eternity, it doesn't compare. Therefore, if I know that I'm going to live forever somewhere, then I'm going to make sure, okay, God, what's the real game plan? What's the real rules to this game of life? Because I'm going to make sure that I play according to those rules. I'm going to play according to that, because I know for a fact that if I die, I wish there was an opportunity where you can get a U-Haul to take all your great things to heaven. You can't even take your body to heaven, let alone anything that you purchase. So why do we get so consumed with material things or a place that's filled with fantasy but not reality? How many people so consumed with fantasy, infatuation, love, and everything that comes with it, so entangled with success and all these things that have been lied to us in culture, we get so caught up in those things that we miss out on reality. Like there's no unseen war against us. Like there's no demons and stuff. Like this thing ain't real. Like we don't have a new president. Our world is going in a certain direction. Like we don't see these things. That's why I laugh at Christians that panic about what happened on Tuesday. As if Jesus ain't God. I was so confused. I'm like, I'm not panicking. My citizenship first is not here. I was born here, but I was reborn there. You got to get it straight. That if he's my king, if he's my God, then he knew Donald Trump was going to be president on Tuesday, November the 8th. It didn't shock him. God was like, oh, he wasn't watching until 2 o'clock in the morning, find out who won it. He wasn't waiting. He was like, I knew before Donald was even conceived in his mother's womb that Donald was going to be president. My people shouldn't be shaken when I'm the omniscient one. I know beyond Donald. I knew before Donald. So if I can know the God that knows beyond whatever's next, I can trust no matter what happens. That shouldn't affect my drive. People was all depressed and said, I'm like, get your money. Get focused. Do what you got to do. Why are you slipping now? It ain't over. Until God says it's over. I wasn't going to go to the song, but it ain't over. Until God says it's over. That's why I understand. I say, you know what, man? My drive has always been about eternity. My ultimate drive is, like I always say, is to hear those two words, well done. No other words are suffice. That's why I don't care what nobody else say. Why why do I care about what people on Instagram say, Facebook say, YouTube say? People talk about, I don't care what they say. I care about what he says about me. I care about having that drive. Why should I get bitter in my jealousy? Oh man, he got better clothes than me. Oh man, he got better this. Oh, she got better. We get so caught up on being bitter jealousy, the Bible says. Like, I'm so jealous that I might want to snatch a fade. Like, I'm that jealous that I might want something bad to happen to that person. That's pretty messed up. It's so sad that we're more consumed. We're living vicariously in other people's lives than in our own. We're living in somebody else's reality while we're not even focusing out. Listen, that's why I say I don't got time to worry about y'all specs. I got beams to worry about. I got to worry about my own. Because if I get rid of my beams, I can see clearly on how to deal with people. That's why I say that's why Christians have lost their impact on people, because they haven't first dealt with their beams. They're so big. How can you deal with someone's speck when your beam is knocking them in the face the whole time? How can you help somebody else when your problem is obvious? Because self-righteousness is more obvious to the world than we think. Self-righteousness is blind to Christians, because we're the right ones. Hellfire and brimstone for everybody else. All of y'all gonna burn. I'm like, look, man, we should be the most gracious people on the planet, because we knew what it took to get where we got. I be telling people, like, you talking about these girls? You was just that girl 2 years ago, 4 years ago. You talking about that guy? You was that dude 3 months ago. So why do we get so caught up on judging the people that we see sinning now like we weren't delivered from ours? That's why we should be driven by the commission. We got to be driven like, let me be transparent enough and be effective enough so that when people see my life, they see no jealousy. Jesus didn't come into the world with J's, yo. He didn't come in the world with the next best thing. He didn't come with no iPhone. He didn't have all the trinkets and the things that we see as the best things in life. He didn't have those things. He didn't. He came the most humble road. But can I tell you one thing? It's best to present yourself in a humble way than in a proud way. Because if you ever want to be exalted, you got to go the humble road. Let's keep going. He desires for us to focus on what other people have and why we don't have. This type of focus leads us to either try and match or surpass what others have, or to try and fill the voids in our hearts with material, emotional things. If you're not the person that's easily jealous, what you're going to try to do is try to fill that hole in your heart that you can't plug anything else in. Meaning most people are going to be like, I don't want to try Jesus. Jesus just sounds so overrated. I tried Jesus, but it was a false Jesus. You tried Jesus, but it wasn't the real Jesus, right? So, because if you really taste and see, or taste and saw, that the Lord was good, you probably wouldn't be living the way you're living. Because when I really met the man, it changed my perspective on money. Your boy ain't really, I invested more money in this ministry than I did in my own self. People be talking about, Josh, why you don't buy no clothes, man? I'd be like, man, it's not that much, it's not that important to me. What's important is to make sure that his ministry looked better than me. It's so sad that the pastor looked better than the ministry, more successful than the ministry. We want to adorn us more than we want to push to Christ. You got to ask yourself, what are you presenting most? Are you trying to present your agenda or his original plan? And most people say, you know what? I got this hole in my heart, yo. I just really want to be successful so bad. That's all I want to do. Because my mom did this, my dad did that, yo. And I went through this when I was 10 or 15. And all of a sudden we're like, you know what? I just got to get there. Listen, do you not know that you're a human being with limits? Sometimes zeal will take you beyond wisdom won't want you to. So many people are so zealous about something that they lose sleep. And I'm guilty of it. I ain't telling you nothing I ain't been guilty of. I used to be up till 3 in the morning working on this ministry stuff. 4 in the morning, because I was driven. But God was like, bro, you're going to burn yourself out. A lot of good men died trying to do something that God was supposed to. Many of us try to reach the world. You can't reach the world in your own strength. You can't even reach your own family in your own strength, let alone your own life. So what we try to do, we try to burn. We're like, I just got to reach the world. It's like, man, do what you're supposed to do. Take care of your body, take care of your family, and then take care of the Lord's work. There's a difference between God and ministry. There's a big difference. God is number one, not ministry, not your career. Because those things will drive you beyond your physical limits. Rappers be like, I'll never sleep. I'm like, bro, you're lying. I know you went to sleep. But they be like, I sleep when I'm dead. I'm like, that's the wrong mind. You need sleep. Sleep is a commodity. Sleep is a, tomorrow, I don't got to work tomorrow. I'm sleeping for like 24 hours. Because I have a problem with this. And I have to always remind myself, Josh, God's going to get it done, man. Do what you're supposed to do and let him do the rest. You burn out trying to do what God. Listen, you can't out-figure out God, man. We be getting whiteboards. Okay, God, if God do be, I better do this. We be trying to fix. God's like, my ways are not your ways. And my thoughts are not your thoughts. If you could figure me out, then I'm not God. His omniscience, his intellect has to be beyond us. Because if his intellect wasn't beyond us, then we'll try to figure him out. That's why I tell people, do not get so caught up when things happen in your life. Let things happen that are supposed to happen. Because everything in life with God falls into place. But when things are falling, it's hard to realize if it is going to fall into place. But if God is doing the breaking, you know it's going to fall into place. But most people go the extra mile. I just got to be successful. I just got to be married. If I could just find somebody, Lord, to lay beside me. If I could just get, listen, man, when you're too driven, your standards go low. When you want something so bad, you'll be like, he better have a 401k, better have a car like this. 2 years go by, Lord, just let him have a Honda, Lord. 3 years go by. No, first, your first standards is, he ain't gonna have no kids. I believe God's gonna have bring me away. You know, y'all know how y'all talk like that. All of a sudden, God, one kid is fine. one kid is all right. Because when you get so caught up on wasting years, wasting your mind on something that God already has fixed, why do we have more Ishmaels than Isaacs in our lives? How many of us have more Ishmaels? I'm gonna do it myself. Isaac still came, but he still had to deal with Ishmael. And how many of us got all these things in our lives that God's saying, you should have just waited on me? I don't want to be a guy with 4 or 5 Ishmaels that I can't even have the Isaac because I don't got enough rooms for Isaac. We got to be in a place where life, you know what, God, put an ease to my drive. The world would teach you, I'm a businessman, man. This game is driven, yo. It's about who's richer, who's successful. This ministry thing is very competitive, if you didn't know. Everybody wants to be the guy at the top. Everybody wants to have the most likes and the most impact. But when you doing it for the people versus doing it for God, the people will burn you out. Everything has to be done with God in mind. I'm going somewhere with this. Give me 1 second. Their goal for you is to build a desire beyond your physical ability and tempt you to utilize a supplement. Many people utilize pills. Many people utilize sex. Many people utilize different things just to get them up the next day to be driven again. How many people, instead of sleep, have supplements? Instead of going to bed, they have these different things to replace what's normal. They give the abnormal normal place. And what happens when you give abnormal things normal place, that thing messes you up. It makes you abnormal. How many of us are cranky because of what we allow in our lives? We don't get no sleep. That's why I be telling people, man, stop bragging about being woke and go to sleep sometime. Stop talking about how woke you are. Like, man, stop researching. Get off YouTube. Like, just leave it alone for a while. You know what I'm saying? Go get some rest. Go take care of yourself. Listen, the world ain't over. Go play ball. Go do something. Just because he's president don't mean you stop doing stuff. I'm like, why are people protesting against Trump? Why? What you do? Be about your business. Be about your life. Let the world handle itself. But know for a fact, the Bible says, 1,000 fall on my left, 10,000 at my right. It won't come near me. God will give his angels charge over me. It doesn't matter who they elect. I know who has been elected. And nobody can impeach him. Nobody can remove him. That's why I said, I'm glad they say Lord of Lords, King of Kings. Because I know for a fact it doesn't matter who's king down here. I know who's king up there. So that should put us at peace. Listen, man. Should you be smart now? Yeah, you probably should be smart. I don't got nothing against the man. I never met the man. It's so sad that we'll talk bad about a person we don't even know. It's best to worry about the life we do know. And that's ours. There's a gap in both of our lives. There's a gap between your desire and your destination. In order for you to get to your destination, you got to have drive. A lot of people, next point, a lot of people are driven, but they are fueled wrongly. They are fueled to either be proud of what they have accomplished or to put down who they are in competition with or who they may have been offended or who may have offended them. This type of proudness and putting down profits them nothing with God. Offense, man. I might have to sit there for a few. How many of us are living life offended? Living life mad at what somebody else did to us. Do y'all remember to repeat it again? Oh, my bad, y'all. I'm sorry. A lot of people are driven, but they are fueled wrongly. They are fueled to either be proud of what they have accomplished or to put down who they are in competition with or who may have offended them. This type of proudness in putting down profits them nothing with God. Being proud and putting people down is the two things that is a fruit of this type of heart. I'm so proud of what I've accomplished. I don't need God. How many of us live like that, yo? We live the bulk of our lives like we don't need him. We treat God like he's a second thought. We treat God like he ain't really giving us air to breathe right now. We treating God that ain't kept many things from happening. Like, we don't reverence him no more like we used to, like we should. Like, man, do you understand who this guy is, man? Like, do we know that this is God? Like, I think we treat God like a president. Like, we'll never probably meet Obama. Probably never will. So we treat him as this, like, this entity that we see, but we don't know. God's like, man, look, you may not ever meet the president, but you're guaranteed to meet me. Do you feel that? Like, we're guaranteed. The Bible says after death is the judgment. It's appointed for every man to die, and after the judgment. So after I die, I got to meet God. The worst part of that sentence is not death. What's death going to do? Death just opened the elevator for you to be in God's waiting room. That's what death does. The music is playing. You got an angel sitting there pushing the button. He ain't talking to you because he don't know what your state is. The elevator rises and you just sitting there like, man, this is a well-lit elevator. The door gets up there and you see God ain't even on the throne. God ain't even sitting there. See, God will make you wait. I think God does that. You know what I'm saying? God be like, I'm going to let him wait for 5 minutes to make him think about his life. That's going to suck, yo. I'm like, God, don't play no jokes with me, man, because I ain't real talk. I might die from anxiety again. You know what I'm saying? I might be like, God, it's too much. But at the same time, that should be a drive, not because we're afraid of hell, but because I get to meet my maker. I get to meet the one that looked out for me. I get to meet the one that was a friend to me. Jesus was driven because of us. He says, for the hope that was set before him, the Bible says, he endured the cross, despised his shame. Imagine what he had to go through just to get us. And the bulk of us don't want him. Imagine what this man was chilling in heaven, this entity, this God, was sitting in heaven. He didn't have to come down to us. We messed up. He could have left us to ourselves. But thankful, I'm so thankful that he didn't look at me as a second thought as we do to him. I'm so glad that he had a drive about him that stretched beyond his ability, that stretched within his ability, not beyond, because his ability was above all abilities. And he came to see about us, and we give him a little burst of something. There's no flame to us, no fervor to us, no passion for him. Like, do you wake up at night just hungry after his word? Do you wake up with a mindset of, man, I get another chance tomorrow? There'll be some nights where I'd be like, God, I can't wait to wake up to get about your business. I can't wait to open these eyes again and get to the next book. This book is done. I'm ready for the next one and the fifth one and the sixth one and the seventh one until I get 30. Because I said I want 30 books out there because I know for a fact there's a lot in me. But how many of us haven't even got one thing out of us that he wants us to get out of us? Because we're not driven. We're not inspired. We're not motivated like we need to be. Because, ladies and gentlemen, we are in the last days. And it's so sad that the bulk of Christians are probably going to die with the bulk of their giftings inside of them. Because we're that close to the end. God's like, well, Your five unwise virgins, they don't got enough oil in your lamps. You got to keep oiling your lamps just in case. You got to stay in close to God just in case. You got to say, listen, that's why don't let this stuff move. You still get what you're supposed to get done. Because God ain't going to hold you accountable for who was elected. He's not going to hold you accountable based upon happening culture. He said, I don't care about them. Well, I said for you to do it. Why are we not so driven? Why are we not so focused? Man, that bothers me about people who are complacent. They get on my nerves. I'm allergic to complacent people. When people talk about, well, Josh, I got this idea. And see, I'm thinking about doing this. And I'd be like, well, are you going to do it? Don't talk to me about if you're going to do it. My question to you is, are you going to do it? God didn't call us to be just hearers. He called us to be doers, yo. What's driving you to do? Because we all do something. We do a lot of stuff. We eat. We sleep. We go to movies, we go to games, we do a lot of stuff. Why do we do these things? Because we like them, because we love them. Compare your doing in the world's way of life compared to what you do for the kingdom of God. It's because we don't have a desire for this. We don't have a hunger for this. One of the greatest okey-dokes the devil can do is to get you to taste artificial flavorings. To get you to taste something that makes things taste well, but it's not good. How many of us are more consumed with what the world cooks than what God has been cooking? That many of us ain't read our Bibles in days. Many of us ain't prayed, but before we get to amen, we sleep. I'm guilty. I'm like, Lord, did I say amen? Did I close this prayer, God? Because this prayer's still going. Because the end of my prayer was snores. Because it's so sad that we'll go in the world's areas to get comfort than to get comfort in Him. I'm not going to preach that stuff or talk to you about that stuff that's going to make you feel, feel good at the end. It's going to make you feel great. The spirit man's going to feel good. I want you to understand the importance of what's really real. Because God really cares about who you put number one in your life. Let's keep going. Our goal should be to work unto the Lord and to ensure He gets the ultimate glory from our lives. This is what we should be boasting in. Verse 14 talked about people will boast in what they have accomplished from their selfish ambition and from their jealousy. We should be boasting knowing that for a fact that I get a chance to give God glory through my life. Listen, man, your gifts was not made for you. Your gifts was made to make sure God gets the glory. Now, that sounds egotistical. People are like, man, why God got to get all the glory? Why can't I get some? It's not that God demands glory. He deserves glory. When I have kids one day, I tell the story every time I talk about this. When I have kids one day, I'll slap them from one end of the room to the next if they talk about that's their dad. I'm like, dude. I'm your dad. No, imagine you at your graduation, at your kids' graduation, they start thanking everybody, and they ain't thank the one that paid for them to go through school. They ain't thank the person that actually fed them. Well, I thank God for my mentor, the guy that was there when I was in ninth grade. I'm like, that man ain't feed you. I don't demand glory. I actually deserve the glory because I provided you to have this glorious moment. So since God is providing us to have glorious moments, we should transfer that glory back to Him. Because if we don't, we're not boosting God's ego. We're just putting it where it needs to be by saying, God, if it wasn't for your air, I wouldn't be able to have enough capacity to do what I'm supposed to do. Everything goes back to God, no matter what it is. Without air, y'all. I wish God could turn the air off for 5 minutes. Everybody would be on their knees, begging Him to cut the air chambers back on. But God said, I'm not going to try to outprove to mere men that I'm worthy. I want those who really love me to find my worth. That's why God don't be out here. God don't play peekaboo in the eastern sky. God don't be like, yo, y'all better wake up. I'm God, yo. And close the clouds back. God don't do that. Because that's going to make people afraid of Him but not loving for Him. He wants people who secretly, through His pursuit, discover His true worth. Because God don't care about a packed heaven. He don't care about a packed heaven. I don't want a room full of people that envy me, jealous of me, want my throne. I don't want all it is, three or four people that have, still have a good time. And we get so caught up on, man, forget God, I'm going to do me. And God's like, man, whoever does, if I forget you, that's a problem. You can forget me, and you know, you can forget me, but if I forget you, Jesus said, man, if you're ashamed of me before men, I'd be ashamed of you for my Father. That thing is like, God's going to be like, I never knew you, yo. Like those things, I don't want to be that guy that stands before God and God be like, I never knew you. He knew you, but he never knew you intimately. He knew about you because he created you, but he didn't know you. He don't know you. It's like, you never spent time with me. You never allowed me to clean your heart. Transition. Let's get to this real quick. Get to exercise. Y'all all right? Y'all learning something? All right. In order for us to be successful in our walk with God and to reach our eternal destination, we must audit our worship, wisdom, will, and work. You know them W, you know it's gonna be four or something. I had to work on that will part. I was trying to find a W for that, but work. Give me 10 minutes and I'll be out your guys' way. In order for us to be successful in our walk with God and to reach our eternal destination, we must audit, keyword audit. That means search through our worship, our wisdom, our will, and our work. In order for us to be successful in our walk with God, because walking with God, ladies and gentlemen, is not easy. You're going to always be in a fight with your old self and your new self. Walking with God is not going to always be easy breezy. It ain't going to always be comfortable because God always brings you through these different things. God's like bringing you through a car wash, man. Like, you ever been through the car wash? I'd be like, man, this thing hit my car too hard, yo. I'm like, man, I appreciate the wash, but man, this thing is banging up against my doors. But sometimes a good wash requires a good push. It requires a good wash through. And many of us just want to go through life with a couple sprinkles. A little mist. God, just give me a mist, God. That's what we want from God. That thing beat up because he says, if you're going to really come out this thing clean, I got to wash hard. And we don't like when God, you know, God washed with that heavy hand. He has to, because our sin is so black. Our sin is so dark. You know, when you got something dark on something, you got to put some elbow grease on that thing. Put some elbow to that. That's how bad he has to clean us. Because he knows for a fact that a lot of us got some dark stuff about us. It doesn't matter if you're the most polite, easygoing person. Your heart by default is wrong. By default, wrong. That messed me up when I was growing up, because I was always in the church. I was that guy that was the golden child. I was that guy where people was like, well, you know, people hated me because I just did stuff right? I was just scared. I was one of them scaredy convicted kids, right? And so what happened was, I thought I was okay because everyone put me in this perfect category. Until one day God rocked the mess out of me and said, Josh, you and your goodness and your righteousness, the Bible says, is filthy rags. Because even your good is wrong. Because how many of us do good with wrong motives? Good, wrong motives. Even if those motives you don't even know you're doing them wrong. Because the heart is so deceptively wicked, you'll do good. I'm tested sometimes when we get tests like this. That's why I tell people, be very careful how you treat the people that you cannot benefit from. God cares about two people that you interact with. He cares about those whom you can't benefit from and those who hurt you. How you treat those people, God really sees close. Why? Because he cares about forgiveness and not being partial. Is it impartial, partial? Partial. Meaning, God cares about how you treat the bellman. He cares about how you treat the waitress. He cares about how you treat those people you cannot benefit from. Because he knows for a fact that that passing by of, that mistreatment of, reveals that I'm better than that person. If you can't hug a homeless person, then what kind of person are you? If you can't really touch somebody else who don't look appealing. When I go in my school, man, those kids don't have everything. But I hug them all equally. Unless they got some ranch on their hands. And I'm like, bro, give me a pound, man. Them kids be nasty sometimes. I'm like, man, look, bro, close your fist, bro. We giving you dap today. Because they be all, I'm not saying that I don't hug them. It's like, but check your hands, bro. That's nasty. You know what I'm saying? You nasty. Just clean your hands, man. Got to start carrying wipes. Because I'm like, bro, before you, I'm not better than you, but I don't know where your hands been. All right? So, just respect, you know? But how you treat the people you cannot benefit from and those who have hurt you matters to God. Because God can care less how you treat those people. Listen, it's so sad that we're a brown-nosed pastor people we're supposed to reach to get to that person. We don't even like that person. We just know he got big wallets. We know for a fact he could fund the ministry. So we smile and juck and jive and treat those people like they're the best thing. That's why I said, man, do not get upset when people treat you poorly. Because I tell you one thing, $1 million painting is still $1 million painting, even if it's been overlooked 1 million times. Just because people overlook it don't mean you're still not the same value to God. Some people overlook treasure, thinking it's trash. Look at over $2 million paintings. People are like, that ain't nothing. Someone go to a garage sale, I know that painting. 5 people don't overpass that painting. But that one person who can actually see the true treasure, that's why I let people go in out of your life. It's not their fault they can't see. It's not my fault you blind. All the people who left you, boy. I'm like, look, man, I say this about my exes, and no offense to those who are watching me online. I'm in my flesh right now, so Lord, give me 1 second, God. I got you, God. Give me about a minute. Remember the person that you, think of a guy, if you're a girl, think of a guy, think of a girl, of the person that you think is like the most handsome, most attractive, most successful, whatever you think is whatever, right? Now think about their ex before they made it big. No matter who that young girl marries or who that young guy marries, they're gonna have a pit in their stomach when they look at Beyonce. That guy gonna be like, I was with Beyonce. Or I was with this person. No matter who they marry, they're gonna be like, dang, they ain't worth $500 million though. Wow. Just because they moved on doesn't mean they're gonna have a pit in their stomach when they see you move on. And so many people may overlook you, and they have overlooked me, but one day they're gonna have a pit in their stomach because they know they was beside greatness. When you're great and people don't see how great you are, the sad thing is people see you where you are now, but they don't see what God is working towards. That's where people are blind, because people walk by sight more than they walk by faith. So what they do is they see your life and be like, they don't benefit me no more. They told me no too many times. I don't see, no, you know what? I'm going to move on. You should have asked God to see what he sees in that person. That's why be thankful that God saw enough to remove that person out of your life, because they couldn't see you correctly. Because if they saw you correctly, they wouldn't have left. That's why I tell people, man, I'm not saying you marry potential, but you better consider potential. But don't just consider potential. Consider the person who's progressively pursuing that potential. Just because you see potential don't mean they're pursuing it. But if you see that joker working towards it, man, I know he don't got no money right now. Man, I know y'all going to these little small restaurants, but chances are that if that man is working towards something, a lot of people missed out who they were supposed to be because they want what they, I'm preaching now. People missed out on who they were supposed to be with because of carnal perceptions of that person. Listen, man, just because it looks a certain way now, just because he or she looks a certain way now, don't let that person go if they're good people. People let good people go for wrong reasons and keep the wrong people for good reasons. Like, people do things backwards, yo. They're driven by other things. Who can, like, people want these, you know what, we get childish sometimes. You know when you're in high school, you just want the pretty girl, and you want the handsome guy, not you, bro, but you want the handsome guy. My bad, my eyes, I'm tired, bro. I'm tired, my eyes get stuck on a person, and I don't forget what I just said. But what I'm trying to say is, let's go to the next point, I forgot, man. Let's keep going. We're going to audit these 4 things real quick. Who or what we worship will always determine our wisdom. Who or what we worship will always determine our wisdom. Whoever we kneel to will determine our knowledge. Many people think they are worshiping God, but they are deep down, envious of his throne and or using his name to accomplish their task. We truly don't worship God like we need to, yo. You know how I know? Because many of us envy his position. Everybody call themselves Hove. People calling them something, something to God. People like, hey, God, this and that. Everybody wants to be God. Everybody wants to be God. I'm like, yo, you know why they want to be God? Because they're trying to find a way to escape the real one. They're trying to find a way to escape the real God. And what happens in life is many people, you would never escape the real God, man. Never. That's why I'd be like, you the God of what, bruh? I'm like, bruh, go step out on a cuss on the edge of earth. I want you to step out there. I want you to create a planet. I want you to create a sun, a moon, and 9 planets. I want you to create a Milky Way. I want you to create all that. And then come back to me. The God of what? You're alive? And your life's a vapor? Many of us are envying his throne, not consciously, but subconsciously. Because you know why? We don't consider him in nothing. If he's truly our God, we'll say, you know what, God? Thank you for saving me. Do we know the weight of salvation, yo? Because the weight of something will determine your drive for it. Its impression on you will determine. All of us are driven because something sparked the drive. Something sparked the flame. Something did it. Just like my interest for basketball started when I was watching the 96 Bulls. It started when I watched Jordan. That's what gave me a spark to play basketball. What gave me a spark for ministry was seeing Pastor Gould when I was 12 or 13. Like, things gave me a spark to get something going. That's why the devil loves setting flames. He loves setting flames in your life to say, go pursue this. You'll love it. Go do it. That's why don't consider everything that's being presented to you. Because you'll start a flame, but you don't have the real passion and fuel to get you beyond the frustration. You need fuel to get you beyond the frustration. Because in this thing, pursuing your own business, being an entrepreneur, being in ministry, you're going to be frustrated more than you are happy. And if you don't feel, you know, if you quit, it shows that's not for you. I consider quitting, but I never quit. Because it's funny, when you consider quitting, you're like, man, God, I'm done, cuz. God, I ain't doing this no more. No more. nobody's putting no respect on my, nobody's doing nothing. I don't care about this no more. I'm done. And God be like, you ain't done. You going to sleep like, God, I'm done. I'm about to delete all my videos. And God be like, no, you ain't. God's like the, I ain't gonna call him a pimp. But God is like the, God, he's not a pimp. He's not a pimp. He's not a pimp. But what I'm saying is, I'm gonna delete that from the video. But what he is though, he's the type of guy that says, I know your decisions beyond your considerations of quitting. I thank God that God didn't give up on me as much as the times I wanted to give up on him, yo. I wanted to quit so many times recently. I ain't talking about 2 years ago. I'm talking about times when I'm like, God, is this worth it? Yo, when I'm writing this third book, I'm like, man, this thing is so tedious. You know, man, I'm tired, man. You know, I wish that I was more successful. Like, I fight these feelings all the time. So I know what y'all go through, man. I know what it's like to be like, God, but God, but God. And God's saying, you're defining my call for you based upon the world's terms. Don't base my definition of success with how the world defines success, because God moves slow, yo. God don't move as quick as the world does. The world moves so fast. Get your money by 25, 27, this, be married, this, bam. And you're like, but I'm broke and divorced. I'm broke and I'm divorced. How did this happen? Because anything you rush in, you'll be quickly rushed out. That's why you got to take your time in everything. Know what you're getting yourself into. Before you step into a relationship, man, are you whole enough for it? Before you step into a business, study the field. Surround yourself with people that know the field. Because if you step into something and you're a lone ranger, man, you ain't going to last long. Point two. We must always audit our wisdom to ensure it's not worldly. Turn with me to 1 John 2, 15 through 17. Not St. John, but the first one. Hold on. St. John's the first John, but the first of the three Johns. Yeah, you got it. Thanks. Appreciate y'all. 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Before you love something or someone, there has to first be an interest. Something had to intrigue you. Something had to interest you. That's why before they build interest, they got to first implement something. Before there's an interest for something, they have to implement something inside of you to desire it. Why do you think molestation happens to certain people to build a desire for something perverted? Why do you think abandonment happens, rejection happens, or even good things happen to spark interest? They know if they spark an interest by implementing something in your life, they'll build your desire for it. So when you build your desire for it, now you become in love with it. Most people don't know what love is because they think love is infatuation. What they want, they don't care about your infatuation. They care about you being so attached to it. They know for a fact is, how can I get them to be interested in somebody through infatuation calls them to have sex? Once they have sex, now they're tied to that person. Now all of a sudden, that's what the Bible says, don't awaken love before it's time. Because when you awaken that type of love, now you blending souls. When you blend souls, all of a sudden, now that person is a part of you now. They just took in something from you, and you have taken something from them, and now you're going to carry that for the rest of your life. Unless you have 50,000 partners, but if you had sex with maybe four or five people, you're carrying them. Images, feelings. Now all of a sudden you're comparing your sexual experience with your husband with the other guys, and all of a sudden he can't even match your love because he's not doing it like he used to, that other person did it. Or when a young girl, beauty begins to fade over time and you become so caught up on looks, now all of a sudden when her beauty begins not to match and mirror, because when you marry somebody or with somebody, everybody puts their best foot forward in dating type of scenarios. They got the makeup on, the hair's done right, the dude brushed his teeth today, you know, things are presented well. But after 6 months, people start getting comfortable. Like, people get comfortable. What starts happening is, I don't gotta put no makeup on you, you should love me for me. What you mean my breast ain't grow? I'm going to brush it soon. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to get my hair. We start doing all these different things because we got comfortable. You got to have a love that stretches beyond when both of y'all get comfortable. But what happens is when you begin bonded with someone, it says love not the world. Don't even be interested in it. Do not even consider it. Because when you love the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life will get you stuck here. But why do you think the Bible talks about lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, the pride of life? Those three things you will face all the days of your life. Eve, she looked at it and saw that it was good for food, eyes, enough to make one wise, a pride of life. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, pride of life. Jesus, the devil said, the same trick. Turn that stone into bread. You hungry, Jesus. Provide for yourself. Jump off this pinnacle so that when people see that you had angels come and rescue you, you can get to your popularity the quick way. Jesus, if you just bow down to me, I'll give you everything on this earth. Stone, lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, desire for people to see me great, pride of life. If you just bow down to me, I'll give you the kingdoms. Jesus was like, first off, I am the bread of life. Second of all, I don't got to prove nothing because my angels wouldn't even come for me. I would not put myself in a stupid situation. That's why you do not test God. God ain't guaranteed to save you from stupidity. Some of us be like, well, I'm just going to drive drunk at 2 a.m. Or I'm just going to do stupid stuff. And when stupid stuff happens to you, when serious stuff happens because of your stupidity, now all of a sudden, where was God? God was like, you, nobody told you to jump off of no pinnacle for no thousand angels to come get you. And the devil said, I'll give you all the kingdom. He said, why should I want your kingdoms when I have my kingdom? When you have the right perspective on life, you won't try to provide for yourself because of lust of the flesh. You won't try to make your life great in other people so they can, so you can feel that applause, so you can feel what it feels like when people see you great. Nor do you have to bow down and sell your soul just to have a moment of a kingdom. Listen, I'd rather have the hut of heaven than the biggest match on earth. I'd rather sweep God's streets for eternity than to have someone sweep my yard and sweep my house. Because no matter what you build here, will be destroyed. But what I'm building in heaven. My dad taught me something when I went to Africa. My dad's house in America is not that big. It's about 3 bedrooms, 4 bedrooms, 2 houses, but it's not that huge. He says, son, he used to always tell me, he said, I got compounds in Nigeria. I said, oh, whatever, man. You swear you got money. Until I saw with my own eyes. 3 compounds, servants, people washing my hands. People were talking about, before you eat, I'm going to wash your hands. I'm like, girl, I can wash my hands. I know you're trying to get to America and all, but I got this. I know your heart. I'm just joking. But that showed me a principle. That in America, he had what most people would see as, that's not a lot. But he's been saving his money to build compounds for his family in Africa. The same principle goes in our life. That I'm not going to be a slave to build mansions here when I already have one over there. Why should I work hard to make y'all drive by my estate and say, man, that guy's successful? To wear the latest J's and the latest suits for people to say he's successful. Most of the rich billionaires walk amongst us every day and we wouldn't even know it. Rich, but wearing the basic clothes. Because showing your wealth is worse than having your wealth that nobody knows. It's wiser to have wealth that no one knows than to show your wealth, because that's how people get their chain snatched. I ain't, listen, when I get money, y'all never know. I might be rich now. I might got some money now, you'll never know it. You ain't know it. All right, let's keep going. Yeah, I had to do it. Culturally relevant, people online again. We must audit our wisdom to ensure it's not worldly. Whoever or whatever we worship will build our fuel or our will. Next point, whoever has our will has the will, and whoever has the will determine what we work towards. My bad, y'all, I'm sorry. Third one, whoever or whatever we worship will build and fuel our will. Uh-huh, you got it? whoever or whatever we worship, oh, I already said that, I'm sorry. Whatever has our will, W-I-L-L, has the will, W-H-E-E-L, and whoever has the will, W-H-E-L-L, I mean E-E-E, Lord, W-H-E, W-H-E-E-L, will determine what we work towards. Man, listen, catch my wordplay. Come on now. I'm trying to be poetic. Let me break it. You don't want me? I'm just joking. Whoever has our will, W-I-L-L.
That was already there.
Oh, that was already there?
Yes.
Has the will.
Right.
Yeah.
And whoever has the will.
Two times.
Two times. Like driving wheel, steering wheel.
Wheel.
Like, listen, man. I didn't finish college. I told y'all this. I told y'all this. I didn't finish school. Wheel.
Yes.
The steering wheel. There you go. Determines what we work towards. We made it through. I'm over here thinking it was garbage. They're going to love this. At home, like, oh, this is going to be a good one right here. This is going to be a good one. It's going to make them go like, that was deep. It didn't work too good. I'm sorry. Final words. I know y'all was happy to hear that. Final words. The fruits of jealousy and selfish ambition are disorder and vile practices. The Bible talks about from these things will be disorder and vile practices. These types of drives will lure you to being unorganized, unethical, and cold-hearted. This type of drive, being jealous and having selfish ambition, will cause disorder in your life and vile practices. These will lure you to being unorganized. Disorder means unorganized, unethical, and cold-hearted. It will also lead you to compromise your convictions and live a life prideful of this temporal life. Being jealous of someone else or having selfish ambition, meaning that I'm going to be ambitious after this to build myself versus building other people in God's kingdom, will cause disorder in our lives. Because what happens when you're jealous and you're selfish and you're ambitious, everything is off kilter. Everything falls into place when God has his rightful place. Everything will fall into place when God has his rightful place. Meaning that when he's number one, everything else, your family, your marriage, your children, your drive, your ambition, your career, your ministry will all fall into place. But when he's number two, everything's still jacked up. Number three, still jacked up. Even though he's close to number one, everything's still jacked up. He has to be number one, and he has to be in the center of everything. He has to be in the center of your marriage, your courtship, the center of your business, center of your marriage. He has to be number one in your life and the center of everything you do. Because when he's number one and in the center, you know for a fact you will be successful. Now, what does that look like? Yo, God, I'm not going to do anything until I acknowledge you, until I consult you. God ain't talking about going to the bathroom. You don't got to ask God, can I use the restroom? You don't got to raise your hand like the kids at our school. You don't got to raise your hand and be like, God, can I go? We're not talking about the basic things. We're talking about marriage, city, friends, everything we have to consider him. Like, God, these are big decisions. If you don't acknowledge him, man, you will lose it all. Unethical. How many, a lot of people don't even want to go the right route? They go the quickest route. And how many people just cold-hearted, man? They just don't care about nobody. That's why I'd rather be, I don't like to bring two people in my life, because you end up with Judas's, man. When you open yourself to so many people, you open yourself up to betrayal. When you open yourself up to everybody, you open up yourself to be betrayed with a kiss even. That's why I keep my circle small, man. I like this stage. Don't get me wrong. I can't wait so I can reach the masses and reach the world. But it's nothing like this. When you actually know the people, you see the people. Because every day I got to check my heart, because the bigger it gets, the more clear I have to see what I'm really doing. That's why God doesn't give us success like that. When you walk with God, you be like, God, I've been walking with you for a long time and I haven't seen no fruit. He said, because I'm still toiling your heart. Before I plant a seed, I have to toil the ground first. That's why the Bible says that many people cast a seed, and some fall on stony ground, some fall on ground with thorns, but it chokes it. So listen, God says, I don't want you to have those kind of hearts. I want you to have a heart that's plantable, a heart that's been mushed and prepped. Because once the seed, the problem is not the seed, the problem is the soil. The seed works, but if it's on the wrong soil, the seed won't work. The most important part is not the seed, it's the soil, yo. That's why God focused so much on plowing our hearts, so that when he does plant a seed in it, it can grow. God deserves your worship and desires to give you a wisdom that is pure, peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, as well as impartial and sincere. My question to you is, where is your fuel taking you? Is your fuel taking you to a place where you're burnt out? Or is your fuel taking you to the sweet pastures that God has for you? Either way, we all are driven somewhere. We just got to ask ourselves, where are we going? Because if you're going to the wrong place, you can go to the right place with the wrong fuel. If you put the wrong gas in your car, it'll jack up your engine. And a lot of us are putting the wrong fuel inside of us, hoping to get somewhere. But the only thing we find ourselves, the only place we find ourselves, is on the side of the road in life. I want to get to that place, but I got to make sure I have the oil in my lamp. And the oil is the Holy Spirit. If I keep him in my heart and I keep him doing what he's supposed to do, destination wouldn't even be a problem because I would surely get there. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this time. I pray that this message was impactful. I pray it blessed each and every one of the people that's listening. I thank you, Father God, for your wisdom. I pray that this message reach the hearts of everyone who's watching. And if God, help us to get to where we got to go the right way. Help us have the right ambition, the right heart, so that we can do what you have for us to do. With that being said, God, we thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would y'all learn something? All right, let's get into some groups, man. For 10 minutes, I'm going to get you guys.